Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Politics, a Very Short Introduction by Kenneth Minogue, narrated by Eric Jason Martin.
Forward. In our time, Thomas Mann remarked, the destiny of man presents its meaning in political terms. This is certainly true for a lot of bores in universities who believe that one cannot enjoy a poem or conduct a love affair without at the same time making a political statement. At a common sense level, this view is no less foolish than the sub-Freudian opinion that everything we do is a sexual revelation. As Yeats responded to Mann, "How can I, that girl standing there, my attention fix on Roman or on Russian or on Spanish politics?" Common sense is the point. In politics, things are real, and propositions are, more or less, true or false. People bleed and die. Politics, with difficulty, sustains the common world in which we may talk to each other, and philosophers who dissolve experience into perspectives, horizons, sensa, values, dominations, cultures, and the rest will destroy that common world. Politics is the activity by which the framework of human life is sustained. It is not life itself. The skeptical philosopher, the moral relativist, the rancorous academic social critic, the religious visionary, and the artistic seer have their place in our civilization, but their intrusion into politics has not been happy, especially during the last two centuries. Experience shows that politics, for all its capacity to order many ways of life, needs to keep its distance from these adventures. Yet the activity of politics is human life at a stretch, full of heroism and duplicity. To understand it is to know how varied it can be, at this time and that place. This introduction seeks in a short compass to place politics in both a disciplinary and a historical context. It attempts to bring both the theory and the practice of the activity into a common focus, and along the way to slough off an error or two. But the author fully realizes that one man's error is likely to be another's enthusiastic commitment. K.M., September 1994. Chapter 1. Why Despots Don't Belong in Politics. The story is told of how Harun al-Rashid, the caliph of Baghdad, would disguise himself as a beggar in order to discover what his subjects were thinking. Surrounded by the flatterers who cluster round absolute power, he could discover the truth of things only in devious ways. Harun was the caliph reputed to have condemned Scheherazade to death, who so charmed him with her stories from evening to evening for 1,000 nights that he delayed her execution and eventually married her. This story is a famous image of despotism, a system of order created by conquest, resting on fear, and issuing in caprice. In a despotic system of government, the ultimate principle of order issues from the inclinations of the despot himself. Yet, despotism is not a system in which justice is entirely meaningless. It has generally prevailed in highly traditional societies where custom is king, and the prevailing terms of justice are accepted as part of the natural order of things. Each person fits into a divinely recognized scheme. Dynasties rise and fall according to what the Chinese used to call the mandate of heaven, but life for the peasant changes little. Everything depends on the wisdom of the ruler. In the 11th century BC, the Israelites, having trouble with the Philistines, went to the prophet Samuel, who ruled them, and asked to have a king who would both judge them and lead them in battle. Samuel warned against this move, advising that such a king would seize their property and enslave their energies. But they insisted that they wanted to be like other nations, and a king they must have. King, in this Middle Eastern context, meant a ruler who would deal despotically with them, a governor quite different from the constitutional rulers of Europe. As it happened, The Israelites were fortunate to have in Saul, David, and Solomon a line of notable rulers who gave Israel a short taste of order and even some international glory. Solomon's solution to the problem of two women both claiming the same baby is but the most famous example of his legendary wisdom. But even these monarchs proved oppressive, and in the end, the burden of paying for Solomon's grand schemes split Israel apart. Despotism is a catch-all category containing large variations. In one form or another, non-European civilizations have almost invariably been ruled despotically. The Western imagination, however, has generally been repelled by despots. Cruel pharaohs, deranged Roman emperors like Caligula and Nero, exotic and remote emperors in India or China. In Europe, the desire for despotic power must disguise itself. Europeans have sometimes been beguiled by a despotism that comes concealed in the seductive form of an ideal, as it did in the cases of Hitler and Stalin. This fact may remind us that the possibility of despotism is remote neither in space nor in time. Many countries are still ruled in this manner, and it can threaten pain or death at any moment. It is like living in a madhouse. Today, we define despotism, along with dictatorship and totalitarianism, as a form of government. This would have horrified the classical Greeks, whose very identity and sense of superiority to other peoples was based on distinguishing themselves from the despotism endured by their eastern neighbors. What this contrast reveals is that politics is so central to our civilization that its meaning changes with every change of culture and circumstance. For this reason, our first move in trying to understand politics must be to free ourselves from the unreflective beliefs of the present. One aim of this book is to explain how it came about that what used to be a limited activity conducted by the elites of some Western countries is now thought to be the inescapable preoccupation of mankind. We need to look first at the value the classical Greeks attached to politics. What the Greeks knew above all was that they were not Orientals. They often admired the magnificent cultures of Eastern empires such as Egypt or Persia, but usually disdained the way in which they were ruled. They called this foreign system despotism because it seemed no different from the relation between a master and his slaves. As warriors, the Greeks despised the practice by which subjects coming into the presence of an Oriental ruler prostrated themselves. They found this an intolerable form of inequality between citizens and their rulers. Over 2,000 years later, we inherit precisely the same reflex rejection of prostration, partly because the language of prostration has become the image by which Christianity recognizes the distance between the human and the divine. When we discuss these matters, we often use the Latin term domination. The Greek despotes and the Roman dominus both signify the specific form of power exercised by the master of slaves. The modern use of dictatorship and the 20th century coinage of totalitarianism are among the many recent signs of the undiminished centrality of this idea in our self-understanding. The essence of despotism is that there is no appeal, either in practice or in law, against the unchecked power of the master. The sole object of the subjects must be to please. There is no parliament, no opposition, no free press, no independent judiciary, no private property protected by law from the rapacity of power. In a word, no public voice except that of the despot. Such powerlessness is, oddly enough, the reason why despotisms are notable generators of spiritual enlightenment. A reaction sets in against a world governed by the caprice of power, and thoughtful subjects take up mysticism, stoicism, and other forms of withdrawal. The essence of life is then found in a spiritual realm beyond that of the senses, and social and political life is devalued as illusion. The result is usually scientific and technological stagnation, except in the short term. Despotism flows so naturally from the military conquest in which most societies originate that creating a civil or political order must be recognized as a remarkable achievement. Europeans have managed it on three notable occasions, and on two of them, the achievement collapsed. The first was in the city-states of classical Greece, which sank into despotism after the death of Alexander the Great. The second was among the Romans, whose very success created an empire so heterogeneous that only a despotic power could prevent it from falling apart. The first of these experiences generated Stoicism and other philosophies of withdrawal from the world, and the second was the seedbed of Christianity. From Christianity and the barbarian kingdoms of the West emerged the medieval version of politics, from which in turn evolved the politics of our modern world. Since we live within this experience, we can only catch it on the wing, as it were, and we do not yet know what its final destiny will be. We do know, however, that the rejection of despotism on which the Western tradition has largely rested is now ambivalent. Many in recent centuries have dreamed of using the irresistible power only found in despotism for removing the evident imperfections of our world. The project of despotism in Europe, even of a philosophical or enlightened kind, would fail unless its real character were concealed. Since politics is in part a theater of illusion, new names and concepts are easy to invent. And in the 20th century, totalitarian versions of the dream of despotism constructed a vast political laboratory in which different versions of the project of creating a perfect society were put to the test. That they failed is currently recognized by all. It is less widely recognized that such immense convulsions must correspond to profound tendencies in our civilization. To understand politics must therefore include studying the signs which might tell us what is going on beneath the surface of this and other fault lines in our civilization. One widely recognized clue is the current state of the distinction between private life and the public world. The private world is that of the family and of individual conscience as each individual makes his or her own choice of beliefs and interests. Such a private life would not be possible without the overarching public world of the state, which sustains a structure of law appropriate to a self-determining association. Politics only survives so long as this overarching structure of public law recognizes its own limits. As Pericles put it in his famous funeral oration for Athenians killed in the first year of the Peloponnesian War, "We are free and tolerant in our private lives, but in public affairs we keep to the law." The actual boundary, both in law and in people's attitudes, between what is public and what is private is, of course, constantly changing. Homosexuality and religion, which used to be publicly regulated, are now largely private, while rape within marriage and abuse of children are increasingly subject to law. It is the fact of recognizing such a division which distinguishes politics, we may loosely identify it with freedom and democracy, from despotism. In the classic despotisms, everything in society was the private property of the despot. But in the modern world, this basic distinction has been steadily eroded from the other side. Ever larger areas of private life have come to be publicly regulated. If everything controversial is called political, and if, as a popular slogan has it, the personal is the political, then nothing is left outside the scope of control by government. This argument has not been universally accepted, but it has been the basic premise of 20th century totalitarianism, and its effect is clearly to lock the individual within a single system of control, destroying the inheritance of distinct and independent roles, economic, religious, cultural, social, and legal, which modern states have until recently enjoyed. Slogans such as "the personal is the political" are proposals for action disguised as truths about the world. The meaning of such slogans is often obscure, but they contain sleeping implications which may awaken in new circumstances and demand policies which affront other cherished values, such as individual freedom. It is said that the price of freedom is vigilance, and an important form of vigilance is attention to political rhetoric, which often reveals how things are going. The beginning of wisdom in politics is attention to signs of change. As a theater of illusion, politics does not reveal its meanings to the careless eye. Reality and illusion are central categories of political study. The problem begins with the very names of institutions. The dominance of Western fashions means that every country now has a kind of politics and a complement of institutions, parliaments, constitutions, schedules of rights, trade unions, courts, newspapers, ministers, and so on, which suggests that the same kind of thing is going on all over the world. Nothing could be further from the truth. Japan, for example, has a figure called a prime minister, and many mistakes have been made by foreign statesmen who are frustrated to discover that the Japanese prime minister cannot deliver national policies in the way that rulers of other countries sometimes can. Again, in 1936, Stalin promulgated what was widely claimed to be the most advanced constitution in the world, awash with rights and safeguards for the people of the Soviet Union. The reality was that Stalin was at that very moment engaged in purging the Soviet elite in faked trials. His subjects were being shot by the million. It is not unknown for politicians to lie, but much more confusing is the complex relation between names and reality. Above all, the name of politics itself. When concepts are stretched too far, they snap and lose their usefulness. Politics used to refer merely to the actions of monarchs, parliaments, and ministers, and to the activities of the politically committed who helped or hindered their accession to authority. Everything else was social or private life. With the expansion of the power of governments, nearly everything has come to be described, in one way or another, as political. We may mention here just one of the many reasons for this. Governments wishing to claim credit for all good things, and oppositions wishing to dispense blame for all bad things, have colluded in spreading the idea that all things, good and bad, are caused by political policies. This idea can turn subjects into petitioners of government, from which all benefits seem to flow, and that in turn reinforces the idea that everything actually is political. There is another reason why politics has expanded its role and meaning. It has immemorially in Europe been the business of monarchs and their servants, and history has largely been the narrative of their doings. To participate in politics has thus been to attain a kind of immortality. When Fidel Castro first attempted, and failed, to take over Cuba in 1953, he defended himself at his trial in a speech declaring, "History will absolve me." He conceived of himself theatrically, an actor on the stage of history. Whoever seeks a kind of immortality in history goes into politics. Potential Cromwells are no longer content to be guiltless of their country's blood and to end in the silence of a country churchyard. They go into politics. The French Revolution brought just such fame to otherwise obscure individuals like Robespierre, Danton, Marat, Charlotte Corday, Saint-Just, and others. Revolutionaries are the graffiti artists of history. These are the extreme cases, and for the most part, this passion in its milder forms has been satisfied by giving everyone the vote. Universal suffrage is, of course, a form of inflation which has diminished the value of a vote, but it remains essential to our conception of what it is to be a proper human being. Alice makes her mark on history, headlined one British newspaper reporting an elderly black South African voting for the first time in 1994. We moderns, and especially those who think of themselves as postmoderns, are peculiarly liable to fall into confusion about the nature of politics. We have invented ingenious reasons for thinking that our ideas are superior to those of our ancestors. All cultures believe that their own ideas are the only right ones, but educated people today are unusually locked into the prejudices of the present moment. The doctrine of progress, for example, suggested to many people that our convictions were grander than the obviously defective ideas of the past. Contemporary intellectual fashion does indeed reject the idea of progress and emphasizes how much we bear the imprint of our place and time. It affirms that one culture is the equal of another. This has the appearance of a form of skepticism liberating us from the arrogance of our ancestors, for it seems to reduce our opinions to the same level as those of everyone else. That appearance is an illusion. Contemporary skepticism is a fake humility, masking a dogmatic conviction that our very openness makes our relativist humanism superior both to the dogmatism of the past and the intolerance of other cultures. Whoever writes about politics must therefore warn against the dangers of the parochialism of one's own time, and this is certainly no less necessary today than before. This widely recognized danger is the reason that the study of politics has always been at the center of a liberal education. Greek and Roman aristocrats studied law, philosophy, and the art of public speaking in order to fulfill the political vocation indicated by their birth. Politics could be the core of education because it very quickly became a self-conscious activity which provoked reflection and generated a superb literature. Philosophers like Plato and Aristotle explored its conceptual structure. Historians like Herodotus kept alive the story of its development. Political scientists, Aristotle for example, studied constitutions and how institutions worked. Aesop turned political wisdom into fable. Memorable orators like Demosthenes and Cicero assembled the forms of argument most appropriate to persuading an audience. Poets wrote elegies and satires on political themes, and political situations were the events which most fired the imagination of Shakespeare and other dramatists. There is no form of understanding and imagination which has not taken politics for its theme. Many are the mirrors of politics, whose substance can only be grasped by consolidating these images until they compose a coherent scheme of understanding. The politician's immediacy and the Don's detachment alike have much to offer. We must try to incorporate both. What Machiavelli sought as the effective truth of politics is merely what is relevant to the activist. It leaves much out. We must begin by looking at the very different ideas of those who laid the foundations of our conception of politics, the Greeks and Romans. Chapter 2. The Classical Greeks. How to be a citizen. Politics among the ancient Greeks was a new way of thinking, feeling, and above all, being related to one's fellows. Citizens varied in wealth, beauty, and intelligence, but as citizens, they were equal. This was because citizens were rational, and the only appropriate relation between rational beings is that of persuasion. Persuasion differs from command in assuming equality between speaker and listener. Plato provides a noble vision of this form of political life in his dialogue, The Crito. The philosopher Socrates, having been sentenced to death for corrupting the youth, refused the offer of help to escape Athens, arguing that to flee would be rationally inconsistent with the commitment to the city expressed in the way he had lived his whole life. Even the mode of his execution reflected this basic belief that violence was not an appropriate relation between citizens. He was given a cup of hemlock to drink. The Greek freely obeyed the law of his polis and was proud to do so. His very identity was bound up with his city. The worst of fates was exile, a form of civic death sometimes imposed by the convention of ostracism on Athenian statesmen whose power was thought to threaten the constitution. Among the Greeks, we find most of the conditions of freedom, a life lived among equals, subject only to law, and ruling and being ruled in turn. The Greeks were the first historical people to create societies having this form, Certainly, they were the first to create a literature exploring it as an experience. Politics was the activity specific to this new thing called a citizen. It might take many forms, even the debased forms of tyranny and usurpation, but on one thing the later classical Greeks were adamant. Oriental despotism was not politics. Such is the formal position, and these were the forms which left so deep an imprint on our civilization. The reality was no doubt a great deal more complex. Democratic and oligarchic factions fought bitter battles within cities. Farmers lived on the edge of destitution, and bad harvests might impel them towards debt slavery. Equality within cities was not matched by equal relations between cities, and war was endemic. The Greeks were a talkative, passionate people, and their politics was often violent and sometimes corrupt. None of this qualifies, however, the fact that they were capable of brilliant exploits, such as their victory in repelling and ultimately conquering their Persian neighbors. In reading much of the literature of their time, we find it easy to think of them as our contemporaries. Being rationalists, they speak across the millenniums to us, their cultural descendants, with a deceptive fluency. For all the common ground, however, they were immensely different from us in their religion, their customs, and their conception of human life. It is this difference which makes studying their civilization so exhilarating. The Greeks were humanists, but of a kind strikingly different from the humanism transformed by Christianity found in the modern world. Their basic proposition was that man is a rational animal, and that the meaning of human life is found in the exercise of rationality. When men succumbed to the passions, they were shamefully descending to a lower form of being. When pride or hubris led them to think they were gods, they lost sight of their human limitations and suffered nemesis, the destructive resentment of the gods. The secret of life was human self-knowledge and a balanced expression of one's human capacities. In deliberating about law and public policy, man found his highest and purest form of self-expression. It could only be enjoyed in the political life of the city. Humanists often look to the Greeks as ancestors, but their view of the world has one remarkable, and in modern terms, disturbing implication. Since some are less rational than others, so also are they less human. Slaves in particular are defective in rationality when compared to masters. Those who explored this view, above all the philosopher Aristotle, were perfectly aware that some slaves are clever and some masters stupid. They were merely expounding what they took to be the rational foundation of the institution itself. Again, women were taken to be less rational than men, though Aristotle considered the barbarians to be quite wrong in thinking that they were indistinguishable from slaves. Citizenship was thus confined to free adult males, and in some cities, not even to all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.